All right. Good evening. What an absolutely beautiful day the good Lord's given to us. It is good to see those who are in our sanctuary tonight. And it's good to be with those that may be watching online. Am I good? Is it hot enough, Bert? I can't hear. Okay, all right. So we want to welcome everybody to our Wednesday night service here at Mount Holly, North Carolina Second Baptist Church. Hope that you've had a great Easter. Hope that wherever you are tonight, you're doing well. As always, there's our address, phone number, email, and again, any way that we can pray with you, come along beside of you, we would consider it an honor. Out of Psalm chapter 86, verse 10, we find these words: "You're great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. You're great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God." As you can hear in the background, we're going to sing one of my favorite songs. Hymn number 147, "How Great Thou Art." If you can, please stand as we worship together.
Savior.
Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble how great thou art. Then sings my soul, thy Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Amen. Father God, we never get tired of thanking you for being a good God and a gracious God and a great God. And we thank you, Lord, for what we not only got to celebrate over the weekend, but what we get to celebrate every day of our life as a child of God. Lord, your death, your burial, your resurrection, your ascension, all that you have done for those of us who have placed our faith and trust in you, for the victory we have every day. You allow us to wake up and the victory that will be ours forever because of all that you have done for sinners such as I. Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks. We adore you. We're grateful, Lord, for an absolutely beautiful day that once again you have gifted to us, for the chance to be here tonight, for our kids, our youth, adults, for all who are here as we study more about you and your word. Lord, I pray that you would be honored in everything that will be said and everything that will be done. It's in Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, real quick, for those that may be watching online, my apologies. Sunday we had issues. We've had a lot of calls Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and some today. So I apologize. We just didn't get everything out correctly. So we will continue to do better. I hope that you were able to find somewhere that you could worship at another place. But please accept my apology. We will continue to work on trying to do better with what we put out. So, thanks for your patience. Thanks for your concern. Thanks for your calls and your emails. At least I know that you're watching, and we'll keep watching. we'll keep trying. We've heard these words. We know these words. They are promises to God's kids, and they're promises from God Himself. Here's the words. It's out of Hebrews 13, second part of verse 5, where the Word of God tells us, I'll never leave you. I'll never abandon you. I'll never forsake you. I'll never forget you. We know those words, so please help me tonight, and I'll repeat what you say. What do those words mean to you tonight that the Lord has said to us, and whatever we're going through, I'll never forsake you. I'll never abandon you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forget you. What do those words mean to you tonight? So whatever you're going through, to know that God is with you, there's comfort. Okay, thank you. What else? What do those words mean to you tonight? I'll never leave you, forsake you, forget, for abandoning you. You go ahead. Okay. So look, we have strength. We have strength. Okay. Talk to me. What else? What do those, man?
Security,
confidence. Okay.
Protection.
Peace. Everybody's looking for peace, man, to have that peace of God, that peace that passes all understanding, peace with God.
I think the most important thing is we have someone.
Yes, that's interesting. To know that we have someone, capital S, who is our source, capital S, and whatever we're going to. Good, that's good. All right, what else?
The source of
Yeah, yeah. And he's the source of our comfort, strength, security, confidence, protection, peace. He's the source. What you got, Pat? I saw your hands moving.
Oh, I'm just thinking.
Oh.
Yeah. Peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control.
Okay.
I think the most outstanding thing I have is we have in our daily routine, and we have him with us. When I have a crisis, I mean, that's all I can stand
on. When you're going through a crisis, to know that you have someone to depend on. Okay, good. Can you think of anything else? To know that. Sir?
Yeah, God's
yeah, absolutely. He cannot lie. He will not lie. He does not lie. What he says he'll do, you can depend on his word, whether you like it or not, agree with it or not. Good. That is his promise. Guaranteed. You think of anything else? This is just introduce. Yeah. Yeah. You cannot lose your salvation. He's you can lose the joy of salvation. you can lose the rewards of your salvation. But you cannot lose your salvation. That's interesting. Because, you know, we've been studying some stuff. We'll study some things. And those that he loved, he also punished. Like I said, when we get into Jeremiah, it's a fascinating study. And I'm trying to outline that entire book while I have a chance. And that's just been fascinating. That he loves, but he also punishes. He turns his kids over into captivity, turns his kids over into exile because those that he loves, he disciplines. You know, we don't like it. We don't like that discipline part, but he's a disciplined God. Anything else? All right. So with that in mind, you remember that song says, no, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. That went through my mind as I was reading this particular song. And I was thinking about how to introduce this. So with that in mind, let's go. Grab a copy of God's Word, Psalm 119. Psalm 119. It's, of course, we know this is the Word of God Psalm, also known as the Wisdom Psalm. Our study tonight is verses 145 through 152. Psalm 119, verses 145 through 152. We're making progress. This is the 19th section. This is the 19th stanza. This is the 19th letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and I listened to it many, many times. Hope I don't destroy it. It is pronounced cough. It's kind of like you're coughing, but a little bit more than cough. All right, 19th letter, 19th section, 19th stanza of the Hebrew alphabet. As we always do, we'll work through verse by verse. At the end of each verse, I'll stop. Should you have something that you have in your study Bible or just something that you'd like to share, please do so. I'll do my best to repeat what you said for those who may be joining. So here we go. Psalm 119, beginning in verse 145, the first part says, I cried out with all my heart. And so right off the bat, again, we don't know who the psalmist was. We're not exactly sure what the background was, but we have a cry. We have a prayer. We have a plea from this particular psalmist. He's asking for action. He's asking for attention from the Lord. So we gather it is a very, very passionate prayer because when you look at it, he says, I cried, I prayed with all my heart. Some translations have with my whole heart. Some of the things I read says with every fiber of my being. Someone else said with everything I'm about. Okay, so I need to confess. I call a timeout in the first 14 minutes of our service. I read just those first couple words. I cried out with all my heart. Okay, so I read the first 7 verses. I put my pen down. Nobody's sitting in the office. It's just me in the mirror. It's just you in the mirror. Sometimes you just need you in the mirror to do a good evaluation examination. So I took my mirror out, and I said, okay, Roger. How long has it been since you prayed like that, buddy? I just put it down. I said, okay, Roger, how long has it been? How long since you really prayed like that? You preacher, yeah. You teacher, yeah. Okay. How long has it been since you prayed like that for your family? How long has it been like that since you prayed for friends, for lost people, for this church, for other things that you're personally aware of going on this was Monday, going on right now in the lives of people that you know and don't know. All this stuff, good night, y'all. Every day, something in our nation. Every day, a killing in a school, in a mall, in a bank, you name it. It's every day. And I'm not going to blame the guns, because you can put every gun you want on that carpet. That gun does nothing. It's the evil heart and the wickedness heart of people struggling for many different reasons. We've got to do a better job. Yes, I understand. But, you know, you see all this stuff going on. And so I did. I said, Roger, how long has it been since you prayed like that? And I had to deal with that, y'all. And then I want to ask you tonight. You don't have to answer. But I want to ask you, how long has it been since you prayed like that? And then I want to put it like this for all of us there, here. How long has it been since we prayed like that? We know their needs. Good night. There's needs everywhere. We could really stay here a good while and cut the camera off and just put together a lot of things that I'm aware of that need to be prayed for the next hour. But how long has it been since we really prayed like that and prayed like this? I think it was you, and you might help me remember. You saw a billboard lately. But when's the last time we prayed? I think this is what you said. As if our life depended on it? Was it something like that? If your job was to pray, would you still be employed? That was a great question. But how long has it been since we prayed as if our very life depended on it? All right, so look what he says. I cried out with all my heart, answer me, Lord, help me, Lord, hear me, Lord. I will comply with your statutes. I will obey your word. And so the first verse is a prayer of desperation. It's a prayer of determination. Lord, I'm going to be obedient to your word, whatever comes my way. What you got? Does anybody want to be froggy and jump on 145 and share anything? You don't have to. I'm just, because I'm allowed to stand in front of you, I get to confess and I get to share personal things.
I think that we, as a Christian, we know that prayer is an important part of our life. But it's very easy to get into a rut where it's a habit. Rather than actually doing what he said, you put your whole heart into it.
That is so fascinating. That's so fascinating, Doubt. I'm going to repeat everything you said on the first Wednesday night of May. The first Thursday of May is always National Day of Prayer. For whatever reason today, I could not get that off my mind, so I did a study several hours this morning just reading and looking and thinking about praying. And that's one of the things that God convicted me over, that sometimes we know we need to pray, we know we ought to pray, but sometimes it becomes a ritual. And we're lukewarm and we're casual, but there's no passion, there's no emotion. And the Lord convicted me of that also this morning. But you're right, good. What else? You see anything else on 145? Because 146 is very similar. Yes?
Even people that say they
Yeah, well, let me see how to say this. There are a lot of people that say they pray to God, but you cannot pray to someone you do not know. So the only way you can pray to God is through a relationship with God. The prayer of an unbeliever, Lord, save my soul, he hears that prayer. Other prayers he does not hear. There is no relationship. And if we're out of the will of God, and our prayer life will be hindered. If there's any iniquity in our lives, our prayer. So you have a lot of people talking about how they pray to God. Such is not the case. Number one, you got to have a relationship. Number two, you've got to be in the right position. Again, this is stuff that's so fresh on my heart because it's what we're going to talk about the first Wednesday night of May. And that's why it's so fresh on my heart. I saw this today and it just hit me. I thought, my gracious, this is exactly what we're talking about tonight. But yeah, anything else? Because like I said, I'm sorry, somebody say something.
When did you start to say, Roger, if there's any iniquity in our
heart? Yeah, it's if there's any iniquity, if there's anything in our heart tonight that we've not confessed and dealt with, we can pray, but there's going to be a barrier. It's going to be a barrier until I am in the right position. In fact, the scripture we'll talk about on National Day of Prayer is James 5, second part of verse 16, where it talks about, and you got different translations, the effectual, the earnest, the fervent prayer of a righteous person availeth much. So when you do that study, when it talks about being right, that means you got to be right with God. You got to be right with yourself. You got to be right with others. If we're not in the right position and the right place, there's going to be a blockage. There's going to be a barrier. So lots of times I can honestly say sometimes because of issues with family or issues with church folks, issues with this person right here, there's been times I have prayed and I've wasted his time and I've wasted my time because I was not in the right place and I was not in the right position. Does that make sense?
It does, though.
It's there. It's not coming.
And if we have, well, say if we have.
Somebody help me. Got a dictionary right there.
Unbelief.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are ways that there are many things that block our prayer life. Disobedience, unconfessed sin. There's many things that block our prayer life. That's why it's very important that we make sure when we're going to pray that we're in that right position as far as we know. That it's right with us. Like the song, it is well with my soul. That tonight, standing in front of God, as far as I know, standing in front of God, this is just being honest. As far as I know, I don't have any wrong dealings or wrong feelings with anybody right here tonight. So I know as far as standing right here right now, I feel very positive about my approach to God. There's many times I couldn't say that. Just again, being open and honest in front of this camera. Well, I'm sorry, go ahead. What were you going to say, Carolyn?
No, I was just listening.
Okay. Yeah. The next verse is very similar. Again, you jump in any time. The next verse is very similar because he says, it's basically a repeat, I cried to you. So again, we see that. I cried out with all my heart. Again, he says, I cried to you. It's very interesting. I didn't know this. Repetition was very, very common in Hebrew poetry. Because they wanted to make sure something was emphasized. You might have dealt with that when you was growing up. If you was out of line, let's just say if you was out of line, this is what I heard. Roger Jr.? I thought, oh, Lord, have mercy on my behind. Because I was talking to my kids the other day, growing up in my household, daddy's oldest was 9. We had a Roger Lee. That's what they call my daddy. We had a Roger Jr., that's what they called me. We had an uncle, Roger Gillis. So when they wanted Roger Gillis, Roger Lee, or Roger Jr., I always hated, to this day, I apologize for family that may be watching. I hate when I go back home. I'm 59 years of age in July, and I go back home, hey, Roger Jr. I'm like, I'm 59 years of age, 3 grown kids and a grandchild, and I'm still Roger Jr. But anyway, I cried to you. He said, save me, rescue me, deliver me. So again, he's dealing with, we'll talk about it some more. We've talked the opposition, the persecutors, those who are lying against him, those who are like that wild animal, they're ready to prowl. They're ready to ambush. He's dealing with all this stuff. So he says, I cried to you, save me. And again, he says, I shall keep your testimonies. I'm going to obey you. I'm going to do whatever I can. So it's basically a repeat to make an emphasis point, repetition. Any thoughts on 145 and or 146?
I think when we... We need to, our prayers need to be out of praise as much as they are out of asking. And we do I do a lot of selfish praying, I think, at times, and fail to recognize
Who is. Again, just being honest, I think we all could be guilty of that, my brother. And I've asked this question before, and again, you can jump on if you don't. How easy it is to complain. But how slow are we to be thankful? And I think we're all guilty of that. And it might just be the circumstances or the situations or the issues, but it's so quick. You've dealt with this. I know people that get so mad at God because this happened and that happened and everything's his fault. But there's never any reason to say, thank you, God. And I'm like, come on, y'all. Let's not just be so quick to fuss at him for everything because that's easy. But let's also make sure we give him thanks and we give him praise. So, yeah.
We want it in our time, too.
Sir?
We want it in our time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Kind of like the microwave. Hurry up. You're taking 2 minutes to pop my popcorn. I don't have, you know, yeah. We want everything quick, man, quick, quick, quick. And that's not always the way he works. I've had to learn it. You've had to learn it. Any other thoughts on those two verses? Man, I really appreciate, yeah.
So many times we say, thank you, God, for unanswered prayers.
Oh, yeah. Not his will. Yeah. And thank God. And I've shared this with you before. This is not original with me. I don't know when I first heard it. It's been years and years. When we pray, he does answer. Sometimes yes. Sometimes no. Sometimes wait. Sometimes move on. My grace is sufficient for this moment. So he does answer, but it's always going to be what is best for our good, our growth, and his glory, and what's going to bring him honor. So yeah, that's right. That's right. Yes, ma'am.
I read the Bible sometimes. I know God talked to me one time when my husband died, and I was questioning God. You know, why?
Oh, yeah.
Then in my quiet time, I called out to God. And I said, I'm afraid that you were not supposed to question God. So I had this guilt trip going. And I apologized to God. And I said, God, I am so sorry. But him being such a wonderful father, he told me, he said, Carolyn, you were not questioning me. You were crying out to me in despair. And so I think sometimes we beat ourselves up.
Yeah.
Then he asked me, he said, did you ever question your earthly father that I gave you? And of course I had to laugh. And I said, yeah.
Think about our brother Job. Did he not question God?
Yeah.
You can question God. You can argue with God. But you better be ready when he's coming back at you. That's okay, Roger. Well, how about this? How about this? I'm sorry. You know, that's good. Thank you. Anything else on those first? Yes, sir. Have I got angry with God? Oh, yeah, I've shared that with you. I don't mind to share it because, you know, I have people that I love that watch. And they'll say, man, you sometimes maybe you're too personal. I said, listen, if you don't be honest with the church, who's going to be honest with the church? I said, I put my pants on one leg at a time. They need to know they don't have a perfect pastor, and my wife don't have a perfect husband, and my kids don't have a perfect daddy. And I've struggled just like they have. And I said, so I don't mind. I said, I'm not perfect. I don't claim to be perfect. I thank God has allowed me to do a lot of things. I thank God for it. But, oh, yeah, I've been angry with. I've shared that with you. And I disobeyed him, and I've shared that with you. And I think, yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Mr. Gooch.
Don't you think this psalmist is saved?
Saved? Oh, absolutely. No, I hear him say, answer me. No, he's rescued. No, that word is, I see what you're saying. That word is best translated, I think, rescue and deliver me, when he's dealing with the persecutors and the opposition. I don't think he's saying save me salvation-wise.
I agree.
Okay, all right.
Roger, my Bible says save me.
All right, I know, but the best translation is, the best word for that is rescue and deliver me from what he's dealing with that we've studied. Like I said, the lies, the persecution. But go ahead. I'm sorry. Finish your thought.
I agree with everything you said. I've been saying that to get to the next question.
Okay. All right.
He is saved.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But this Bible and her say, saved.
Yes.
From what? I think the psalmist is teaching us that as Christians, the more we keep his statutes and his laws, we will be saved from his wrath and punishment from iniquity. And because the more we walk right with him, the less he will have to discipline us.
It's very interesting that the more we live in obedience to the Lord, the less discipline we'll face. Okay, I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am. Yes. I'm telling you. And right now, thinking about your role, and I'm looking at a lot of grandparents. We've never seen a time like this. And she's nasty. And she's getting nastier. There's a lot of things that I hope you're keeping notes to. I don't go into everything because some folks don't want to hear it. But we're living in the nasty now. And it's intensifying. And if we have never cried out and prayed, I don't know what's wrong with us, because if we don't find our face on the floor praying out to God right now, we never will. I mean, it is our only hope. He is our only hope. Yeah, you're right. Thank you. Great point. You're doing good. I'm not in a hurry. I got this. Anything else on these two verses?
I think that verse of reference you were looking for is Isaiah 59:2.
What was it say?
It says, but your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden your face from you. Your sins have hidden his face from you.
Yeah, that's a good reference. That ain't it. It's one that says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, that's it. Is it 40?
66:18.
That's it. I'll read it. Have you got it right there?
If I regard witness in my heart, the Lord will not hear.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. So if you're making notes, both of them are great. But the one I was wanting is Psalm 66:18. Yeah. If I regard iniquity in my heart, there's going to be a hindrance. The other one is great. Isaiah 59:2. So Isaiah 59:2. Psalm 66:18, again, the call to examine and evaluate to make sure we're in the right place and the right position when we pray. Good. Great. You're doing great. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
He was talking about that. Save me. I have another verse that says, I cry out to you, rescue me that I may obey your law.
Yes. Yeah. Like I said, the best translation from what I've studied is rescue me and deliver me from those kind of things. But I appreciate your intake because that's fascinating. You always fascinated with some of the things that you that's good. I appreciate it. That's how we learn and grow together. All right, look at the next one. 147. I rise before dawn and cry for help. I get up early in the morning and I cry out to the Lord. I seek out to the Lord. Why? Why is he there? I rise before dawn, I cry for help. I wait for your words. I put my hope in your words. I put my hope in you. I've discovered, as you've already said, I've discovered you are my help. I've discovered that you are my hope. And so I patiently wait, expecting you to speak to me. Now that's easy, isn't it? Let's just be honest. How many of us in here are so patient with God? God, I'm going to sit here and I'm just going to wait. Okay, that's long enough. I got to do something. You ever done that? You ever done it? You ain't acted. Well, it's only been 2 seconds. Okay, I'll give it to you. I rise before dawn, I cry for help, I wait for your words. He is patient, and he's waiting for God in the midst of all this stuff he's dealing with. I thought it was fascinating when I looked at 145, 146, and 147. Three times you'll see where it says, I cried, I cried, I cried. And 18 years ago, there was a song, and I won't read it all, but it was entitled Cry to Jesus, and here's some of the words. To all of the people with burdens and pains, keeping you back from your life, you believe that there's nothing and there's no one who can make it right. To the widow who suffers from being alone, wiping the tears from her eyes, and for all the children around the world without home, say a prayer tonight. There's hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. There's grace and forgiveness, mercy and healing. He meets you wherever you are. Cry out to Jesus. When you're lonely and it feels like the whole world is falling on you, you just reach out. You just cry out to Jesus. He could have wrote that song. He could have wrote that song. But any thoughts on 147? Because we're going to connect it with the very next verse. But any thoughts on 147? All right, so 147 says, I rise early in the morning. Watch what 148 says. My eyes anticipate the night watches. 146, I'm rising up early in the morning, I'm crying for help. 148, I'm staying up at night to be with the Lord. Okay, we talk about this. I don't know what's best for you. I know what's best for me. I'm a clockwork person. My kids hate it, but I've taught them all my life. Daddy, I can't stand that. Even before I knew anything about a GPS, as far as you put to your car, I've been on a GPS since I was 5 years of age. And here's what I call a GPS, a good positive schedule. So I go to bed at 10 o'clock. I get up at 5 o'clock. It don't matter what day it is. Don't matter if you're that's my body. My body puts me down. Last night, my body even said at 9:30, go to bed. I was like, okay, yes, it's great. I got 30 minutes extra, man. But that's me because I want to be here. I try to get here by 6:15 in the office every day, except for Friday. Friday, I do it at the house. But that's my schedule to get up because if I don't do that, I'm telling y'all, I'm gonna miss my time. If you don't schedule, and that doesn't sound right, but please hear me. If you don't schedule your time with God, you've got to make sure to schedule. I don't care if I miss a program. Good night. Make sure you've got quiet time with God, whatever is best for you, be it morning, be it afternoon, be it night. Don't you dare miss that quiet time because that's the importance of our relationship and that fellowship and that friendship, that time we need. And so you think about it. I hope I'm preaching to the choir. I hope the choir's turned in their computer. When you think about your sleeping schedule, your working schedule, your TV schedule, your phone schedule, your computer schedule, your doctor's appointments, because some of y'all just stayed at the doctor all the doggone time. I told somebody a while ago, I'm going to ask my family to shoot me if I got to go to all these doctors. But I was just kidding. But you schedule all this stuff you got going on. Here's the question. How much time do you have to spend in prayer? How much time are you spending in prayer? Now, I hate this. I read this and I thought, that can't be right. According to Google and the stats that are out there, of a person who lives 75 years, the average person spends 4 hours out of a 75-hour life in prayer and Bible study. They say the average Christian, 2 minutes and 2 seconds a day on average. That ain't even a commercial, y'all. I mean, if you've ever watched a 30-minute program, half the doggone program is a commercial. So if the stats are true, man, we are doing a bad job. And so we look at all the problems going on in our lives and our homes and our marriages and our thing, and you wonder what the problem is? It might be in the house of God among the people of God who just ain't got serious enough about, like you said a while ago, Rhonda, crying out to the Lord. I mean, good night. I couldn't believe it. I thought, that can't be right. So I looked it up again. But that's what the evidence is. Out of a 75-year lifestyle, 4 hours a day, 4 hours a lifetime. I mean, figure that out, y'all. 240 minutes. I hope that's not right. I hope that's not right. But he says, 147, I get up early and I cry for help. 148, he says, my eyes anticipate the night watches. Why? What's he wanting to do? He says, so that I may meditate on your word. We talked about this word. It means to ponder. It means to just sit and think. If you've ever been around cows and we had them, chew on it. Chew on it. Like to cut. Ponder, think, chew on it. Meditate, really spend time and with the intention of applying. Because it's easy to put it here, but it needs to go more than here. So we meditate with the intention of, yes, going here, and then applying it, okay? That's what he's saying. What you got? What you got on, you can put those verses together, 147, 148. Daytime, nighttime, make sure you got time with God. Any thoughts on those two? All right, I got a crud. 149. Hear my voice. I like this translation. Oh, do hear me, Lord. Hear my voice according to your faithfulness, in your faithful love for me, Lord, in your loyal love for me. It's the picture of a father who loves his kids. Because of your faithful love, because of your loyal love, Lord, please hear me. And then what? Revive me, Lord, according to your judgments. I need to be revived. I need to be renewed by following your word. I was trying to think of how to put it like this. Lord, draw near to me, hear me, revive me or I'm not going to make it. If I understand the heartbeat of this psalmist, Lord, draw near to me, hear me, revive me, or I will not make it. You see an attitude of total dependence on the goodness and the faithfulness and the mercy and the justice of Almighty God. It is a powerful, powerful word. Hear my voice according to your faithfulness. Revive me, Lord, according to your judgments. Thoughts on 149. Okay.
O Lord, revive me according to your justice.
Huh, yeah.
And that justice, that's a big word there. That's a big sentence. The Lord, revive me. And when we're talking about the Lord reviving me, he's been through crying out for his whole heart.
Yeah.
He's been through asking the Lord to hear him. He's been through, I'll keep your statutes. I'll cry out to you. Save me. I'll keep your testimony. I'll rise before the dawn in the morning. I'll cry for help.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. In order to ask God, God, I need revival. I need renewal. You're basically saying I'm not where I need to be, but I need you to help me get there. Again, that's just going back to the mirror of saying, evaluate and examine me. I can't worry about my brother and sister right now. I got to worry about right here. And I want to make sure I'm in the right position that I need to be with you, Lord. Yeah, that's a great point. Great point. Any other thoughts on that? Ma'am.
God has a way of getting us to that point.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Just like the life of David.
Yes, ma'am.
And you know, his heart was broken when his newborn died.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that, all the trouble he went through, you know, one of his sons, I can't remember which one, Absalom? No.
Yeah, Absalom revolted against him. Right. Then you had a lot. Yes. Yes, some of the life issues, some of the circumstances we're allowed to go through, not always easy to explain them, but they're allowed for a purpose and a reason. And some of them we may not ever discover on this side. That's the frustrating part. Will I ever see the fruition of this? And it's possible we may not. It's going to depend on what exactly he wants us, what he wants to reveal to us for such a time as this. It's fascinating. That's good. Any other thoughts on that?
It's almost like we live a selfish life. Because, hey, God, you created me. Now it's your responsibility to take care of me. And that, I think that's the way we get away from praising him and blessing him. Thank you for all the things you've done for us, how you blessed each and every one of us. That's, again, goes back to the relationships that we should be having with God.
Mm-hmm.
And I think sometimes we're too selfish, and a lot in our time, a lot in our thoughts or whatever, but somehow I think we get it to the point that, God, we expect this out of you, but we don't do our part. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Let me paraphrase. Hey, God. I didn't ask to be born. But now that I'm here, you're responsible. Ain't that something? Boy, that'd bless God, won't it? But yeah, so sometimes I appreciate your honesty. And when we get to where we can be honest, things will happen. It's easy to be selfish. We all have that tendency, good night. It's easy to be self-centered. Again, it goes back to what we already said. It's so easy to complain. We're so quick to complain. We're so slow to praise him. Yeah, we really got to just make sure we're where we need to be. It's good. That's good. Any other thoughts on that? All right, look at 150. Here's what he's dealing with. You know, going back to some of the things he said. Those who follow after wickedness approach. Here they come. I mean, we've seen this. The opposition, the persecutors, those that are wicked and evil and lawless, they're out to attack him. They're out to ruin him. died to destroy him, and for what? From everything we can discover, they had no cause whatsoever. Does that sound familiar? Look familiar to what we've just been thanking God for? They had no cause whatsoever. You know, name one sin that you got. Just name one. They didn't have anything. Even in the witnesses they tried, in the things they tried to trump up, there was nothing there. There's nothing there. You know, those who follow after wickedness, here they come. Here they come. Why? Why were they the way they were? Why are people the way they are? Here it is. They are far from your law. When you could care less about God, when you could care less about God's word, when you could care less about God's will, you don't care what you do. There is no conviction. You have no accountability to nobody. You don't have responsibility to nobody. When you don't care about anything to do with spiritual things, you will do whatever. We see it. We're seeing it every day. And then we're going to deal with some things because you remember what the Lord said? This is John 15, 18 and following. He says, if the world hates you, remember to hate me first. The world would love you as one of its own if you belong to it. But you're no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. You remember what I told you? A slave is not greater than the master. Since they persecuted me, naturally they would persecute you. If they listened to me, they would listen to you. They would do all this to you because of me, for they rejected the one who sent me. They would not be guilty if I had not come and spoken to them, but now they have no excuse for their sin. Anyone who hates me also hates my Father. If I hadn't done such miraculous signs among them that no one else could do, they would not be guilty. As it is, they've seen everything I did, yet they still hate me and the Father. This fulfills what's written in the scriptures. They hated me without cause. The psalmist is saying, here they come. They're coming after me. We've seen this several times in our study of this wisdom psalm, this Word of God psalm. And why? Because they are far away from God. We see that all the time. And I'm not making light of this. I hope this comes out right. I saw the picture of that young man in Louisville. And I thought about my kids. My kids are 30, 27, 24. This kid was 30, 25. Sharp-looking young man. I mean, just sharp-looking. I looked at this picture. I thought, wow, that is a sharp-looking boy. Educated boy, financial something, what was his, he had a good position. And you think, what in the world happened? And of course, what we're hearing is, and what we hear over and over and over and over, is mental issues. So I'm not making light of that. If there's someone who's struggling mentally and the parents know about it and people know about it, man, we've got to turn them over. We got to get them some help. This stuff has got to stop. You know, but some of the folks that are doing it, it's not mental. A lot of what you're not going to hear about is spiritual. We're dealing with just evil, wicked people. I mean, good night. It tore me all to pieces as getting older with a grandbaby. And when I saw that 12-year-old kid and that 16-year-old kid and that 17-year-old kid, the three African-Americans that killed the three Caucasian girls, I was like, you got to be kidding, 12-year-old? Why? And we see this over and over and over. It's every day. It's just every day. Today in Gastonia, yesterday the bank, the day before that the mall, the day before that. It's, you know, and so he's dealing with that. They're coming. They're coming after me. Why? Because they're far from your law. And my goodness, again, going back to our prayer and praying, we got to pray for folks who don't see any other answer than to pick up a rifle. Or to pick up this, because it goes mind and heart, man. He's dealing with that. He's dealing with that. They had no reason, but they're coming after him. You know, in the midst of all that, watch what he says. Those who fall out to wickedness approach, they're far from you, Lord. You're near, Lord. You're near, Lord. Here comes the persecutors. Here comes the thing. But, Lord, you're near. And because you're near, I've got hope. And because you're near, I have confidence. You're near, Lord. And not only do we know that he's near, what do we know about his word? I hope we agree with this tonight. A lot of folks don't agree with this. But not some of your commandments, not most of your commandments, but all your commandments are truth. And I believe that. I do. I believe with every fiber of my being standing in front of you tonight, else show me the door. The word of God is true. Cover to cover. There is no error. There is no contradiction. You'll have different approaches as we studied Sunday. John focuses on Mary Magdalene. But if you just sit down and read all the Gospels, you can fill in the details, and they all tell the same story. The women went. John focused on Mary Magdalene. Okay, it's the same story. Up from the grave he arose. You know, it's the same. And when you think about the commandments of the Lord, one of the commandments that we need to claim, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, greater is he that's in us than he is in the world. The devil's working, man. He's working overtime. He is at it. But if his commandments are true, then one of the ones we claim, greater is you that's in me than you that's in the world. You're near, Lord. You got all this stuff coming at him. But Lord, you're near, and all of your word is true. And again, I don't want to assume anything for those watching, those in here. Man, I want you to know that tonight. I don't know what you're going through tonight. I know some of the situations I'm dealing with outside of here with so much at hospitals, nursing. There's a lot happening this week. And I've told people, I said, do you understand that he's near? And I repeat this on purpose all the time. Do you understand he's as close as the very mention of his name? Do you understand that? Because I want people to know that. Because he is. His desire is to be very near to us, and his desire is for us to know that his word is true. You know, and you testify to that, and some of us testify. If we didn't know tonight that God was right here, that God was right here, and his word was true, man, I don't know how we wake up in the morning. I'm glad to wake up in the morning knowing that things are crazy out there, but he's still on the throne. Things are crazy out there, but his word is true. Well, if he is on the throne and his word is true, things are going to happen. But he's still got it. And if he's got it, then that means he's got me. All right? What you got? What you got on one? Put 150, 151. You got anything on those two verses?
Well, no matter how wicked people are or how wicked they get, God is steadfast.
Yes.
And he's reliable.
That's a good word. That's a good word. That's that school teacher word, man. That's good stuff. No matter what other people are, to know God is steadfast, great word, reliable, great word, trustworthy, great word, dependable. Yeah, great. That's good. Yes. What else?
You know, when we talk about lawless people and everything, and here I go back to when I was growing up. I heard about the Ten Commandments all the time. I knew what the Ten Commandments were. They were on the wall in our church. It was preached on all the time. Our Sunday school teacher talked about it. And it seemed like it was out there all the time. And I knew what the Ten Commandments were. And our parents, all right, now you know thou shalt not steal. So it was quoted to us. So have we failed society as a church by not being bold with things like this? Because I don't hear it like I used to. And, I mean, I could say that about myself.
I think to all that you said, let me see how I want to say this. I think, yes, we have failed as individual Christians. I think, yes, we have failed as a church. But I think the best way for us to be out there, and I hear what you're saying. When I was selling books, home interior was big time back in when I was 18, 19, 20. I bumped into a lady in Mississippi, and she had home interior everywhere, and I've never seen so much beautiful stuff. I said, ma'am, how much are those plaques? Ten Commandment plaques. She told me, I said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll give you two brand new large print Bibles right now for 10 of those. She said, you got it. I said, hold on. So I went to the car. I said, here's $100 worth of leather Bibles. I want $100. They were $10 a piece of the day, back in the day. I put them things in my car and I came back home. And I gave one to every member of my family. I said, hang this up. And I still got mine. The way that people will see the Ten Commandments, the best way, is through the way we live. And through the way, and I'm not against, I see stuff posted in people's yards all the time, and I do read it. But while you read it, you're not seeing it lived out. So I do think, yes, we failed. And I think the way to do a better job is when we have those opportunities to speak to people and to speak into people, that's where we can pass those truths along. People will see the truths when they see the truths in us. And I promise you, your grandkids, people that know you and love you, people that live, they're watching. There are people watch us every day. They want to see if we're serious about what we say we believe. And I think that's how we will have that influence. And so I agree. I agree totally. Any other thoughts on that? All right. Let's get to this last verse. From long ago, I have known from your testimonies that you have founded them forever. I like this translation. I have known from my earliest days that your laws will last forever. This psalmist, man, I love to know who it was. I love to know what he was dealing with. He just continues to show me personally such a great confidence in God, such a great confidence in God's word, such a great assurance of God, such a great assurance of God's word. And as I read that, this old hymn, I shouldn't say old hymn, but an older hymn came to my mind. You know the words. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in God's excellent word. What more can be said than to you God has said, to you who for refuge to God have fled. Fear not, I'm with thee. Be not dismayed. I am thy God and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. When through the deep waters I call thee to go, the rivers of sorrow shall not overflow. For I will be near thee, thy troubles to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. That's what came to my mind when I read that psalm, the confidence he had in God and the assurance he had in God and his word. And I thought, man, what a psalmist, what an example, something I need, somebody I definitely would like to pick his brain. And but anyway, what you got? We'll conclude. Psalm 119, 145 to 152. Anything else on your heart, on your mind?
Mm-hmm. But my word shall not pass away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, grass shall wither, flowers fade, word of God will not pass away. Old Testament, New Testament, read it again.
Matthew's
24:30.
Verse 35, heaven and earth shall pass away,
mm-hmm.
but my word shall not pass away.
Right, oh yeah, okay. Same reference. You got the Old Testament reference, New Testament, yeah. Yeah. We're different ages in here. We've been through different things, but I think we can agree on this, looking at all the things we walked through, how God has been faithful from way back yonder, and he's going to continue to be faithful. Should he call us home together? Hey, I'm ready. I got my ticket punched. Should he call us home separately? I'm ready. I got my tickets punched. Either way, to know that we can place everything we're about tonight in God's hands and trust his word. That's good. Good. Thank you. Anything else? And we'll wrap this down.
Know you're on the winning team.
Yeah. To know the victory is yours, that you cannot lose. That's good. As always, thank you so much. I hope everything worked out for you tonight to watch with us. And we don't take it for granted. We understand there are folks that would love to be here. I've heard it all week. And they're just not able. So we're hoping you got this tonight if you wanted to join in with us. And good Lord willing, we look forward to joining in with you again Sunday morning Until then, we hope you have the rest of this evening a great, great evening, and the rest of this week a great week. God bless you.